My colleague Mikael is going to lock us into this nice warm room so that we're all comfortable. My name is not actually spelled with an I with the two little dots. I just wanted to be like Mikael for a bit. So my name is Denis. I work at the Eclipse Foundation. Actually, Mikael and I both work at the Eclipse Foundation. I'm part of the webmaster, the large webmaster team of two individuals. Another person is working back home in Ottawa, Canada. And Mikael spends more of his time on the release side, the builds, and overall Java guru. We wanted to talk today about the builds that we do at Eclipse.org. More specifically, talk about the common build infrastructure that we have. So we're going to talk about how it was like before our implementation of Hudson, what we've done since we've implemented Hudson, what we're planning on doing, I guess, in the near future, some of our plans, and also what the CVI is and how it could benefit you, your project, even if it's not an Eclipse project. What are those remotes? So a very short history lesson about the projects at Eclipse. About 10 years ago, when I started at the foundation, we did not have a continuous integration system, at least not one that we offered to our community. So every project was kind of free to just build their own way in their own little space. And one of the, one of the drawbacks of that is that the build systems of each project were not always understood. They were kind of a bit of a black box. I'm not a software developer, but as a consumer of projects from all walks of open source, I think it's very important that anybody be able to pick up your project code, build it, and actually get up and running. And I think that's one of the focuses that we have at Eclipse Foundation is we want to make it easier for anybody to just pick up project code and build it. So we didn't really have a CI system, at least not anything that we maintained. There were builds everywhere, and quite frankly, it was a mess. And our data center actually still looks like this, but at least our builds do not. So the first iteration of Hudson that we installed at Eclipse.org was about in 2007, and it was essentially a community-led effort. A team of committers installed Hudson, kind of put up a web page and said, hey, we're doing builds this way. And it was great, and eventually the foundation kind of took over the service and figured, yeah, this is really good and this is really important. Our very first implementation was a very large single Hudson instance where all the projects could run builds, but one of the drawbacks is that being very large, it was really hard for us to maintain. It wasn't all that reliable through no fault of Hudson. Just about anything that we expose at Eclipse.org gets banged on, researched, and Googlebot after Googlebot and 65 others. So it was kind of difficult for us to maintain. So the idea that we had a few years ago was to come up with, and this is nothing revolutionary, it was just an application of common sense. We just wanted to use Hudson in a way that it was optimal. So instead of having one very large instance doing everything, we just have silos of Hudsons, one for each project, kind of doing its own thing. And as it turns out, that allowed us to solve a lot of problems. So in terms of stability, if one project is doing something or they want to have a plugin that's a bit different, if their Hudson is unstable, it only affects them. It doesn't necessarily affect everybody else. Excuse me. And also there's a very good isolation with other projects in terms of build space. How we actually went about setting up the Hudson Instance Per Project is no fancy software. There's no big framework here. We just use off-the-shelf components from Linux and other repositories. So essentially, all of the user accounts that we have at Eclipse.org are in a directory called LDAP. So each project that Eclipse has a user, which we consider a participating member of the project. And that user is the one, it's a system account, it's not somebody who actually logs in, but that system account is the one running the Hudson Java process. And since it's a user account, well, we can give that account access to the Git repositories for tagging after a build. We can also give them access to the downloads area for promoting build artifacts, and so on. So we've put a few logos on there of the components that we use for our Hudson Instance Per Project. Nothing really fancy, Linux, Apache, MySQL, a bit of PHP, and Puppet. One thing that we realized after deploying Hudson Instance Per Project is that we needed a whole lot more servers. Obviously, Java processes tend to consume a very small amount of memory, so memory was a very hot commodity for us. And one thing that we do not like as system administrator, we tend to be fairly lazy, as developers are. I think lazy is a good thing, and sysadmins are very lazy as well, is that we did not want to spend our time installing servers. That's not very, there's no value add for you. So we started investigating technologies such as Puppet and some of the enterprise Linux features that are offered to us via SUSE to kind of just automate. We just, you know, we buy a new box, plug it in, and it kind of just boots and configures itself. And about an hour later, we have a Hudson server ready to accept, you know, anywhere from 12 to 50 Hudson instances. We try to use Puppet to push as much configuration onto the servers, so we store configurations in Git. Some of these configurations we cannot store in Git, or we choose not to, passwords, secrets, and stuff like that, that we kind of just stash away and use good old scripts. Now, how do we fit 200 of these Hudsons all on a single domain name? We essentially have a single machine that acts as hudson.eclipse.org, and the only thing that machine does is act as a proxy to all of the other 100 or 200 instances that are hidden behind them. So I got very good at using the copy-paste function on this slide. So you can see every Java process kind of runs on its own TCP port. We try very hard to not have any port collisions, even though the processes are running on different servers. We could reuse some of the same ports, but we wanted to make a system where we could take one Hudson process and kind of move it around from one server to another, depending on the server load or what it is that the project needs. I believe today we have about 10 of these. We call them HIPP servers, Hudson instance per project. That doesn't always roll off the top to the tip of your tongue. And we track all of the Hudson instances in a nifty MariaDB database, so we can tell on which host it is running, if it is running or if it's not running. And that allows us as well to kind of build the configuration file for Apache, so that when we add a Hudson, we just have to, you know, add a record here, and everything kind of just gets propagated in a way that actually really works. So that's a bit the overview of how the Hudson instance works at Eclipse. Looking forward, I mean, we've went from a place where we had no CI system and projects building a bit everywhere, and now we have CI systems that everybody, you know, including yourself, even if you're not on any Eclipse project, you can still peer into the Hudson system of your favorite project, go look at their latest milestones, go look at the build logs, and you can actually extract some information out of that. And that puts us in a much better place. Now, looking forward, we want to provide some better services for our community. For instance, improving the upgrade process. We're trying to make this as self-serve as it can be, allow the committers to not have to wait on us to do stuff. We also want to, as you've seen, Eclipse is a lot more than just Java and the Java ID. We have people that want to build stuff for Raspberry Pis, C builds, native builds, Mac builds, and then signing, and so on. So we start. We have to start investigating, you know, deploying Windows, which is not really my strong suit as a Linux sysadmin, and Mac platforms, and who knows what. You know, maybe our data center will be filled with these at some point, and people will be using these as Hudson slaves. So more of the tools that we want to develop investigate: Vagrant, Docker, being able to run builds and tests in a kind of a clean environment each and every time. So as you know, instead of having one test be able to impact the other tests from one run to the other, kind of just scratch everything, discard everything, create a new environment, run everything, and then tear it down at the end. So those are two of the technologies we're looking at, as well as better integration with other tools such as signing. I think over the years it's become very important for us to digitally sign our artifacts, and making that an easy part of the build promotion process, I think, is very important.
So the Hudson Instance Per Project has been created under an initiative that has been led by the Eclipse Foundation, which is called CBI for Common Build Infrastructure. This initiative has been created after, if you remember how Eclipse was built a few few years ago. It was really hard to rebuild the platform or the SDK from scratch. And so the CBI project has been created with those three primary goals. So the CBI project was about to make it really easy to copy and modify the source, so of the Eclipse platform first, but also for any project, to build and test the changes. So the Hudson Instance Per Project comes here, and to contribute new changes. So around those three primary goals, CBI is actually a set of those three things. So it's a set of tools and technologies that we provide. So Hudson is one of them, but I will show you later that we also provide some SonarQube instances and some Gerrit servers. A set of best practices. So you may know that most of the Eclipse plugin and the Eclipse platform is actually built with Maven and a set of Maven plugins which are called Eclipse Tycho. So the CBI project defines a set of best practices for using Maven and Tycho altogether, and also a set of services like the digital signature thing. So to make it really easy to copy and modify the source, you might not have noticed that the foundation has moved completely to Git. So there is no more project that are using CVS or SVN, except Subversion, because obviously they want to use Subversion.
Does that, nobody uses CVS anymore, right? Everybody's off of that? Okay.
So we completely moved to Git, and now it's the only kind of software code management system that we support. And to improve even more the experience for the projects, we also now allow projects to host their code directly on GitHub. So it's part of another initiative, which is called the Social Coding Initiative. You can think of that little sub-project of CBI if you want. So now you can directly create a project and host it at GitHub. So far, you were not able to use all of the GitHub things like the GitHub issues. The Eclipse Foundation bylaws required you to use Bugzilla, but now you can also use GitHub issues. So it's brand new. I don't know if it's officially announced.
It is now, actually.
Yeah, it is now. No, you are.
It's kind of funny the way these things work, because they announced, you know, 2 days ago that we allow GitHub issues, which has always been a huge point, and within 3 hours we had 6 open bugs wanting to migrate from Bugzilla to Git. It's going to be a very long week next week.
So obviously we have to create some scripts and some services to retrieve all the issues and store it at the Eclipse Foundation, because we have to be able, in the case GitHub go away, doesn't make sense anytime soon, but we have to be able to restore it on any Bugzilla or any kind of other system if GitHub goes away. That was the primary goal, so we switched to Git, and to make it really easy to build and test the changes, I told you that we are promoting Maven and the usage of Tycho, the set of plugins to build a set of Maven plugins to build Eclipse plugin and Eclipse feature and products and all this kind of thing. So there are a lot of documentation on the CBI wiki about that, and also on the Tycho website, obviously. So the presentation started with introduction of of the HIPP. So we are providing a set of Hudson instances for each project. So you are totally free on these instances. You can create any number of jobs that you want. And if you require some more executor of this kind of thing, we can talk about that, how we can help you shorten the build time, this kind of thing. We can also give you administrative permission, but with great power comes great responsibility. So if you ask for administrative permission, you will basically have to be responsible for any kind of failure that the Hudson can have, and we just have some backups of your jobs config, but no workspace or no plugins configuration that you would add by yourself. Otherwise, we administrate it for you.
There's a few people who might not know what Hudson is. It's kind of like Jenkins.
Another goal of CBI is obviously to make it easier to contribute changes. So after the migration to Git, the obvious solution was to install a Garrett server at Eclipse. So now we are providing a master Garrett instance for all the projects. So whenever you want to contribute a change, you just have to push a change to the proper branch of Garrett, and it will appear there. And the committers will get a notification that your change has been submitted, and they should review it.
I'm going to interrupt you again.
Yep.
You,
oh,
do you mind?
No.
Can, may I?
No,
does anybody here use Garrett? 1, 2, 3, 4. The rest of you, I suppose, use GitHub. Some of you. If you're not using Garrett, I'm just curious how you do your code review. Okay.
Okay. So we
carry on.
We provide a Garrett instance, but obviously with the social coding initiative, if you host your project on GitHub, you can use pull requests instead of using Garrett reviews for reviewing your contribution. So we make it really easy to use it. But if you use our Garrett instances, we also have nice things like a bot that for any new changes submitted to Garrett, we will parse the commit message, and if we find some fancy bug number or this kind of thing, we will directly add a comment to the bug that a new new change has been submitted, and we get a nice link to the review. We will also push a new comment if the review has been accepted, but we won't close the bug. Still up to the project to decide if the new change, the new accepted change, actually closed the bug or not. Another thing that we provide along with Garrett and Hudson is the ability to trigger a build every time a new change has been submitted to Garrett. So here you can't see. You cannot see that a new change has been submitted, and Hudson listen to the Garrett instance and directly run the build and add a comment, add a +1 if the build is green or blue, or I don't know which color you use for a good build, but it had the messages, and you know that you can review the code and it actually passed all the tests that you define in your job. So that's really a big enhancement for accepted contribution, because you don't have to retrieve the change and build it before starting to review it. It will be done automatically by Garrett and Hudson. So what else we are doing? So here you can see some of the IT staff busy with.
So that's me on the far right, and I'm just pretending to tell them what to do.
So CBI is also providing some other services. So we provide an Eclipse instance. So we have a Maven repository hosted at Eclipse. The URL is repo.eclipse.org, and every project we want to publish the artifact in a Maven repository, we can give them access to this Nexus instance, and we actually configure every Hudson instance with the permission to publish bits to this repo. So far, some projects use it, but a big request has been to be able to publish to Maven Central. Unfortunately, we cannot synchronize our instance with Maven Central because we are using the open source version of Nexus. And Sonatype does not allow the synchronization between Maven, an open source instance of Nexus and Maven Central. So it has been a request for a long time, and we finally figured out how to provide the ability to project to publish directly to Maven Central. And for that, we are using WPG, GPG. So we know we are now able to create a GPG key pair for your project. And we also handle the creation of the Sonatype account for you, for your project. And we set up everything on your Hudson instance. And then when you choose, you do a Maven deploy with the proper profile and the server ID, it will be directly uploaded to the Maven Central and the Sonatype open source repository, which is then synchronized to Maven Central. So only three projects use it so far, because it started a month ago. So like that, but if you want to publish to Maven Central, just open a bug on community at some we will set it set up for you this week.
Wait till next week.
Yeah, wait for
next week.
Another thing that CBI provide is a Sonar Cube instance. So does everybody know what is Sonar? Who don't know? Okay, so Sonar is a project quality dashboard. So when you run a Sonar build, it actually use checkstyle, PMD, find bugs, and all this kind of really good stuff to analyze your source code and provide some analysis of the results in a nice dashboard. It started as a community thing, so a bit like Hudson. So some guys started wanted to install a Sonar instance at Eclipse, so we provided them a vServer, and they configure it and handle it by themselves. But with the time, we found out that many projects wanted to use it, so the Eclipse IT team took it over, and okay, so now it's official service provided by the Eclipse Foundation.
We do a lot of that. We allow the community will ask us for a lot of tools. We have almost 300 projects. We can't possibly run everything for everybody, but we kind of let the community decide. And often what we do is, as Mikael said, we'll give them a virtual server. We'll say, hey, you install that. Show us how it works. Show us that it's really, really valuable. And then, you know, if the projects really like it, we will take it over. So we did that with Hudson. We did that with Sonar. And we're getting ready to investigate a complete ALM suite, which a few projects have asked. Which, I mean, I don't know much about the technology. So again, we'll give the projects a virtual server. They'll install it there. They'll show us how it is that it works. And we're hoping that the community kind of picks up and says, yeah, we really want that. We'll make it an official service. And that's really how we evolve our infrastructure, is by listening to what people want.
And we also provide other services, so the digital signature thing we talked about before. So we provide some facility to sign your jar with the jar signer mechanism from the JVM. So it's a digital signature that is checked when you actually add a jar to the class path. So at runtime, the JVM is able to check that a jar is properly signed. So the Eclipse Foundation provides a certificate, and you can use it. You can sign your jar with provided web service. Of course, you have to be an Eclipse project to use this. We also provide some facility to sign Windows executables, so you won't have any kind of bad pop-up that, oh, this executable is from an unknown source, so you have to accept to run it. So any Eclipse product is signed with our certificate, and it avoids this pop-up. And we also sign the OSX.app thing the same way to avoid this kind of pop-up. Other services is a packaging one. So maybe you know that in macOS, you often install things from a DMG file. It's basically a zip of the application, but it has really nice integration with the OS. So we now provide a service to package the app into a DMG. I know that many people want MSI file for Windows, but nobody raised their hand to implement it, so we don't have it yet. But if you want to do it, just open a bug and say that you want to. We will also soon, meaning 2016,
next week,
of course, provide a publishing and promoting service, so you won't have to create any bash script anymore to publish your P2 repository to the download area. You will just upload the zip, and we will extract the metadata from that and add it to the download area. So we still don't know if we craft this thing by ourselves or if we will use some nice project like Package Drone. Maybe you heard about that, as I was a presentation yesterday. So we're still trying to figure out how to do that. And a new thing also that we provide is a documentation with generator, website generator with an Eclipse theme. Based on Hugo. So Hugo is basically a tool that translates markdown files to HTML files, and the goal is to provide some facility to create documentation and website, and to make it as easy as for as creating new pages on GitHub with the GitHub Pages facility. We think it would be really valuable for the community.
Are there any questions?
I'd be my fault. then once a vote for a garret change?
No, unfortunately no.
Okay.
The you can trigger any job from your garret, from the garret link with Hudson. So far, not a lot of projects do that because sonar analysis takes a long time and they want to have the feedback much quicker than waiting for the sonar instance. But you can, definitely. It's up to you if you want to wait for half an hour before having the feedback.
I have two questions actually. The first one is, what is the status on the building on several platforms? You talk about that, so OS, OS X and so on. So what is the status today about that?
The status today is that we're tired of waiting. So one of the challenges that we faced mostly with Windows is licensing, and that's not something that, and yeah, as an open source foundation, we're not used to having to deal with that because we use open source everything, and for that specific reason. However, after some fairly lengthy discussions with Microsoft, in terms of so one of the problems is that we want to do the testing on the same platform that the developers use, right? Not some version of Windows Server that nobody actually uses to write code. It just doesn't make sense. So one of the things that we were waiting on was confirmation that we were in fact allowed to use a desktop Windows in the way that we are intending on using it. And the answer is yes, we are allowed to do that. So we're done waiting, and I think in the next months we will be deploying, we will enable Windows slaves for those projects that want to do either native builds on Windows or testing. Did I say that? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we will also add the ability to have your own slave with custom Linux distribution. So far we are using SUSE, but you will be able to have Red Hat and Ubuntu, all this kind of thing if you want to have more fancy Linux distribution.
So expect to see some of those in the next few months. Not next week, but in the next few months.
Second question is, I love the feature of having a wiki, which is also a Git repository, so you can clone it and change and push it. So you provide some kind of such?
So a wiki as a Git repository? Is that what?
Yes.
Yeah. I've never even heard of it.
But basically, it is what we provide with the documentation generator thing
that's
that I was
question,
talking about.
Yes.
So you will host your Markdown file in a Git repo, maybe in the same one as your source code, but it could be another one. And so far, it's still manual to create a job on Hudson to be able to push directly from these Markdown files to the 3w.org Git repo where we host all the HTML files. But we can do more automation on that topic, so we basically have the wiki in your Git repo because we have the Markdown files and they will be automatically retrieved, built and published to the...
So I can have this feature by just using the project Git repo.
Yeah, it's really similar to what GitHub does with the wiki and the GitHub pages.
Bitbucket does that and it's quite sexy.
Actually, that was a feature that nobody asked us. I just saw one of our websites that had a edit on GitHub button and it sent you over there. You could do a pull request and they could merge your change and boom, it just happened on the website. I thought that was really, really simple. So that's, I'm the one who opened the bug and said, we need that, and then obviously very useful.
Okay. That was a question? You had a question?
Yes. You said that the results of Sonar are not used as an answer in Garret, right?
Yeah.
So my question is, how do you react to the change of data inside of Sonar? Because I understood you do a review in Garret and you see Hudson says it's all okay.
Yeah.
You look through the code and you say, okay, I'm fine with this, so I'm going to merge it to the dev branch. And but what is with the data inside of Sonar?
Okay, so it's up to every project, to each project, to decide how they will use Sonar. From what I know, most of the project runs a Sonar analysis once a day on their master branch, and they don't really care of the results of Sonar from their review. But if you are a naked project and you really care about code quality and you want to use that to use Sonar more, you can definitely create a job on your Hudson instance and say, okay, so this is a job that will be triggered by Gary preview, and you will then get the results of the Sonar instance directly in the results of the build, and it can say -1 because it does not meet the quality criteria that you set.
But then of course you'll have to wait, right?
So
because the process can take pretty long.
Yeah. Yeah, unfortunately Sonar analyses are quite long because they actually run PMD, find bugs, check style all together.
Yeah, I guess it's a code analysis tool, so it doesn't just look at the 10 lines of change that you've done and say, hey, are they okay? I guess that's what the build check is.
We had that too, but someone eventually we decided to turn it off because it just takes too long to get the results. And we want to we want to go towards continuous delivery. We want to do the change. We want to do the review. We want to click merge, and we want to have it sent shipped to the users.
Mm-hmm.
So then, in that scheme, we don't have time to wait an hour for the results of someone.
What I used to do on a project I was working on before joining the foundation was running a Sonar analysis once a day. Because it's a nice dashboard and you can go to see how we evolve, how we change the code quality, are we increasing or decreasing the quality. And on the Garrett build, the build triggered by Garrett, we actually run check style and find bugs to do the minimal analysis. We only a minimal set of rules that we decided that are very important for us. And this is quite fast to run if you reduce the number of rules. But Sonar tries to find too many rules for us.
Yeah.
So it can be a compromise that you can make, but still the dashboard is really interesting for analysis of a long time because you have a timeline. You can you have a time machine and you can see how your quality has evolved for the last 3 months, for instance.
Yeah.
Perhaps one thing that would be an interesting experiment would be to leverage Hudson to automate running Sonar once a week, and because at eclipse.org our Hudson users are our system accounts, they can post comments on bugs if it's configured that way. So once a week you run your code analysis, and depending on the output, you could configure the parameters of, hey, we found too many that figure way above, well above what we would consider acceptable, and it would file a bug for you to investigate, right? So there are ways of leveraging Hudson as a tool to kind of automate stuff that you would normally run manually once a week for this.
That sounds good.
I think we've never done that. I'm guessing that this data is probably available through an RSS. You know, there's ways of getting these numbers in an automated fashion.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I do it.
Other questions?
All right. If you have any